would you, well, because you are representation, and it, especially in relation to what you said about leadership, what kind of, what would be a good leader in your view? And I also agree much with what you say. The big task is it's what happens after the event, after the revolution. But what are your substantive vision of how to organize good politics, and in particular with regard to representation and leadership?
Something horrible. No, will I maybe answer? I see your point. First, do we agree on this? First, let me tell you again that where it works at a local level, it's wonderful, this local communal self-organization and so on. I just claim that, A, it cannot be universalized as a model. For example, at the end, I think of Empire or of the next one, Multitude, I don't know, in almost a religious fervor, Negri and Hart wrote, but a moment will come when all these local multitudes will take over the entire field and so on. And at the debate that we had in Berlin at the Second Communism Conference, I asked Negri, I asked him a simple question. It was, all the examples that you give of multitude organizing presuppose a very efficient state apparatus. And exactly the same goes for all those local communes, communities, factories who take over. There must be an efficient state apparatus providing energy, water, legal order, and so on for this to work. I ask him, can you give me just one example that even theoretically would function where you have, as it were, multitude self-organizing itself without state? Just to provoke him, I told him I know only one example, Khmer Rouge in North Korea. But okay, then he was thinking and then he said cultural revolution in China. I have doubts there, because first it's clear that there is no cultural revolution without an extremely strong charismatic leader. But okay, to answer your question, my answer would have been a much stronger, well-organized state and new means of democratic controls from a referendum to whatever, which would not be necessarily of multi-party nature. They would even look more, how to put it, for some people even, I don't like the term fascist, but I think that we should stop this bullshit about state is something horrible and so on and so on. More and more we, by we I even mean humanity, we will need to rehabilitate a mega large organization. Look, let's be serious, already to fight ecology, transnational mega project will have to be done. And I wrote in the book, I said that some of them are already planned, we even don't know, they're terribly risky, like the idea is maybe it will have to be done, but it makes me afraid. Did you read about this? That they already planned? One idea is to disperse above into the air, above tiny particles of iron or whatever, I don't know what metals, so that they will collect blocks. And it's. But can you imagine first what a mega operation this will have to be and how risky it is? Because, you know, nature is not a good mother, it's a dirty bitch, you never know. You know, like, you do this, there can be effects there and so on. I see precisely a need for, I don't believe in this magic of, like, here for me, Deleuze is too capitalist in the sense that he believes in this not planned, not organized, local self-organization which somehow then creates a larger community. So my idea is rehabilitate the regulative role of the state. The first thing we have to learn, and Americans are too stupid, they didn't learn it, is that good democracies are more organized than totalitarian systems. It's a totally wrong vision to say Stalinism was too totalitarian in the sense of over-organized people's individual initiative while the West is too chaotic. Listen, read good books about Stalinism, especially later Soviet Union, then Brezhnev. organization. Nothing worked. You have to bribe, you have to improvise for everything and so on. So you see, the tragedy of totalitarian states for me, it's not that they are over-organized, but that they are precisely over-chaotic. Look at today's example, North Korea. The state has collapsed. It cannot even provide rationed food and so on. So people have to, self-organize, grow vegetables, go to the forest to pick berries and so on and so on. I think that we should gain this basic insight, this full awareness of the extent to which freedom is something that you can actually enjoy only within a very well articulated, organized social totality, and so on. So now I know I didn't answer you concretely in the sense of what political system and so on. But here I don't think the problem cannot be resolved. But again, another problem again. It's for me, for example, absolutely clear. Here Keynesians are right that. And it's not a moral point, who dirty bankers. I think this criticism of bankers as dirty profiteering should be prohibited. It just blurs the problem. Because, wait a minute, as if when people say today corrupted bankers like Bernard Madoff and so on, I say, what are you trying to tell me? That once bankers were good or what? And only now, I mean, bankers were always. The problem is what changed in social structure so that they got a chance. And here I think that, let's take the case much more than, okay, clear cases. Cyprus and years ago, how do you pronounce it? Reykjavik is a capital of?
Island.
Yeah, not Iceland, Island. Okay, Island. Look, this is simply a case of madness. A couple of private bankers engage in speculations, and then if they fail, the whole state goes bankrupt. So obviously, banking system will have to be put under some control. And all I can tell you is that it works. Because countries which are exploding economically, like Singapore, China, South Korea, oh my God, banks are not free there, I can tell you this. So I'm for a much more organized society.
So,
can I ask a question?
No.
Thank you, Comrade Stalin.